downstairs is when I look at myself in the mirror, so that I have a stain on my shirt. So if anyone has an adult bib that I can borrow, I really appreciate it. Never fails. Anyway, all kidding aside, you know, it's a beautiful day.
Yeah.
Glad that all of you could make it. I was, yeah, I just caught this thing. Okay. NC, there, okay. So I was thinking about this for the past few days. Last night I'm sitting in my apartment watching TV, and all of a sudden, oh, I have to open service tomorrow because Suzanne's not going to be there. So I started thinking and asking God to give me a word to share today. And I feel this is what he wants me to talk about, and I kind of got confirmation after Mike gave me the list of songs. So I want to read you this scripture and then share some thoughts that I put down. The creation of the world. This is Genesis chapter 1. I'm going to read the whole chapter, so bear with me. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters. And God made the expanse and separated the waters that were under the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse. And it was so. And God called the expanse heaven. And there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit, trees bearing fruit, in which is their seed, each according to its kind on the earth. And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night. And let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars. And God set them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the heavens. So God created the great sea creatures and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarm according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creeping things, and beasts of the earth according to their kinds. And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps on the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." And God said, "Behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast on the earth, and to every bird of the heavens, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. So after God created the earth, and he saw what he had created, what does it say? That he saw that it was good. You know, this is the first time that everything that was created is seen. So he created everything in this universe that we see, hear, taste, touch, and smell. So I was thinking about this, and I was thinking, you know, it's hard for us to remember when we experience things for the first time, because when we become adults, we're more concerned with the outcome of things. We want to know what will happen, when will it happen, how will it happen. Mm-hmm. Why? Because we want to be or feel in control. It's hard for a person to have uncertainty in their life, and this is what causes us to make decisions based on emotions. Right. With God, we need to be patient. He has told us that he will do things for us. So how can we go back to that state of experiencing things for the first time? Well, simply all we have to do is look at a child. Observing a child will give you a natural display of a sense of wonder. A child's world is viewed through the eyes of wonder and excitement. He is in awe of life and views life through innocence, purity, and curiosity. So think about this. Every day is a new beginning for us. The Lord gives us blessings every day, and we should experience those blessings as if it was the first time that we had seen them or received them. Amen. Let us be like a child, you know, wide-eyed and mystified. Let us be like a child when we stare at the beauty of our King. Yes. May we never lose our wonder.
Yes.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So, with that, anyone has any prayer requests, testimonies? Yes, Peter.
Just a couple things. Had one of the most difficult weeks at work last week. I was seeking the Lord about it. I believe he was telling me that it's because he's closing the door there. So I just, you know, favor and wisdom to find a new job. And secondly, I was at an event yesterday and had a lady scream really loud in my ear. And ever since then, it's been ringing and been in pain. So I just need healing for it.
Jesus, Lord, right now. Jesus' name.
Just continue prayer for my wife. You know, just lift her up. And, you know, with Zach, I had prom last night. He's such a good kid. I'm just blessed. You know, it's like what you're saying. You know, when we begin to, not just with our family, but, you know, you share God with friends, that, you know, you'll hear different things. And then when you're able to share with somebody that may not know, you know, what we're blessed to know what we do at this point, right? It is like a little kid, that rush, you know, every time it comes back, because you're talking about God, you're expressing, you know, the things that you know personally at that point in your life, and then when you share that. But, you know, with Zach, you know, he's 18, he's graduating high school, he's heading on to a new chapter, and it's just, you know, while it's really cool, it's really freaky at the same time. But, and I know there's been much experience in the room, you know, in dealing with it. But just, you know, I know that's in part with my wife. She deals with a lot of guilt, shame, and then with Zach graduating, you know. So I just pray that, you know, that she is able, her mind is able to receive what God has already put in place for her, and that she's able to receive it. And to be able to experience that healing touch that he's already provided. So, you know, just for my wife, my son, for
Jesus responded to this guy's faith in him, not in his own faith. The guy didn't have faith in his faith. The disciples were asking, what about our faith? What's wrong with our faith? It's faith in Jesus. It's the faith in what he does, not what we can do or how much power we think we have, or, you know, those moments of euphoria almost where we feel like we can, you know, leap over a troop and take over, you know, the victory for ourselves. So I would say, you know, what Jesus wants you to do is rest. Rest in his promises. Keep your focus on him, not on what everybody else is saying, not on all the circumstances that keep coming, not on the natural stuff, but on Jesus himself. And don't worry that you have doubts. I don't think anybody has ever had a relationship with Jesus that didn't have doubts about something at some point. But that's why he comes to us. You know, it's called grace. We're not able to do it all. But the very fact that you believe in him, the fact that you even have these questions, is evidence of saving faith. That's how we come to him in the first place. We don't know. We're just saying, God, I want to believe that you're a savior. I want to believe that you'll deliver me. But I'm not sure. I mean, I want to believe it. If there's anything you can do, have compassion on me. The bottom line is, Jesus did. Yes. He didn't say, hey, when you get your act totally together here, when you've got perfect faith, when your act is right, when your righteousness is all right, when everything is good, then come and ask me from a pure heart, you know, total confidence, and I'll heal you. No, he dealt with the guy right where the guy was.
Exactly.
I believe, but help my unbelief.
Exactly.
And Jesus healed the boy instantly.
Yes.
We need to rest in his love, not in our, you know, abilities to, you know, to spiritualize things. We're all flawed, but the beauty of it is he's done all this for us.
Yes.
He wants us to rest in him, have confidence in him, not in our faith, not in our abilities. Just try to dial down and rest in what he's promised.
Amen.
And keep the focus on him.
Amen.
And not anything else.
Yes.
All right. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Also, a friend asked me to lift up her cousin a few weeks ago. She fell down some stairs and hurt her neck. And after a few weeks, apparently the doctors came back and said that now she needs surgery and needs to have some plates put in her vertebrae and all that. So just for total healing. And then when the surgeons go in, they just basically close her back up because there's nothing to be done.
Amen.
Justine.
Yeah, I just want to be thankful that I firmly believe God wants me here for a reason, and I want to thank everybody who goes out of their way to pick me up and make sure I get here. I like the community spirit of the church. I believe God puts people in our lives for a reason.
That's right.
And
yes.
I'm thankful.
Amen.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you,
Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Sheila.
Evelyn's going in for some heart dust in the morning. She asked for prayer.
Jesus that he always wanted to keep that connection with his father. He had the crowds and you just go away and you spend that time with him.
truthful with him. I'm letting you know, hey, God, I'm struggling with this. I don't see the big picture. I don't understand things. Lord, just help me. And sometimes that's all it takes.
Yeah.
Just, Lord, remember me. There's a lot of those prayers in the Bible.
Yeah.
When people said, just remember me. You know, they didn't have a long drawn out, just remember me, Lord. And the thing is, God says, I will remember you.
That's right.
You know, you're engraved on his hands. I mean, he's with you through the whole time. And I always get a picture. I've had my kids, you know, when you walk them across the street, why do you walk a 2 or 3 year old across the street holding his hand? Because he'd let go, you know, and run out because he don't understand all the things around him. God said, I'm going to hold your hand. You understand?
Right.
Just holding my hand. They used to have that song, hold the God's unchanging hand.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way it is. I love that. I remember when I first got saved, they sang that song like every Sunday. But hold to God's unchanging hand.
Amen.
And he's not going to change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And that's something we can never, ever forget.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
transmission trouble, which you probably take it to a transmission shop. You have teeth problems, you go to the dentist, you go to get your TV fixed, you take it to the repair center. Well, these people are calling out to you because they know that Jesus is the end result and this cancer is healing and it's all being drawn to you. There are things called familiar spirits, and they may not know where they're going, whatever, but the Lord, the Holy Spirit, is drawing people to you because you have the answer. And with you being confident in what He has done, His healing power of that cancer will now be released.
Yes, yes. Praise God.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
All right, well, let's stand. Let's thank the Lord for bringing us together this morning. Father, thank you for your presence. We thank you, Lord, for all your blessings, for your grace.
James was talking to me on the way over here this morning, and a lot of things going on that he's facing. And I thank you for his faithfulness. The Lord was speaking to my heart yesterday about the first song we're doing, and apparently he's talking to other people too. And then I was watching a video back from 1997 this morning. I didn't know there was going to be any worship at the beginning of the video. I thought it was just going to be a message being brought forth, but it just happens to be the same song we're starting out with this morning that I prepared for yesterday. So God's on the move. But as James and I were talking on the way over here, you know, it seems that we get so out of focus, and it always seems to our conversations turn about ourselves instead of others around us. And as Pastor was preaching on, I don't remember, it was Wednesday or last Sunday, everything's a blur right now in time, but it's about him, circling around him, all about him and his kingdom and his purposes. Where are we in our orbit? Are we orbiting around him, or are we orbiting around our own things? And as I was coming up Hubble ready to cut on 37th Street, the revelation came back to me of what's going on. And he said, just look at the lilac bushes on the way. Do you realize there's 14 to 18 big old purple lilac bushes just from Hubble to here? I couldn't believe. They were just all over the place. And he says, and this is one of the things that my hand has touched for this time and this season. And I know they'll flower and bloom, and then they'll die, and then they'll come back in next year. But right now the season is on for them. So there's a season of things that the Lord wants to do in your life right now. So don't miss the opportunity. I know he wants to speak to you this morning, and I know he is here already. We already know that. And I know that there's healing in his glory, and I know that there's healing in his presence. And I just want to love on the Lord. Will you join with me this day as we love on the Lord? Hallelujah.
I have felt the wind blow.
your name. Lord, let our lives reflect your love for us, Lord, to a dying world that needs your love. Show your love, for your mercies are known forever, Lord. I believe in your finished work, Lord. I believe that you love me, Lord. My debt and sins are gone. My debt and sins are gone. I believe it, Lord. I believe it, Lord. You are taking the dark things out of this world, Lord, replacing with your light, Lord. Taking my doubts and casting away my fears, Lord. Think and understand the fullness of things that you have done, Lord. Jesus, you are my unfailing love. You are the finisher of my faith, Lord. I cannot do it on my own, Lord. We tried for over 3,000 years to do it on our own, Lord, but we have failed. We have failed, but you did it all, Lord. Lord, help us, Lord. Renew our minds, Lord. Renew our hearts that we will understand the power and the authority that you have given us, Lord, to reach the lost and the needy, Lord. Those that are bound in religion and tradition, Lord, and man's ways, have mercy on us, O Lord. Have mercy, Lord. Restore our thoughts, Lord. Failing
God. Let's lift our hands to the Lord right now. Praise God. Just expect God to do whatever it is you've been asking, whatever you've been praying for. Expect it right now. Don't expect it next week or next month. Expect that it has happened. Amen. You have it. Praise the Lord. Amen. We'll let the doctors and the bankers and everybody else catch up. Amen. But we have it in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. He has restored all things. Praise God. Even the years that the locust and the canker worm, amen, the years that we were lost and going crazy, it's all been restored, amen, in Jesus' name, hallelujah. Praise God, and the latter end will be greater than the former, praise the Lord. Give him a big hand clap this morning, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God, praise God, hallelujah. God bless you, may be seated. Thank you, worship team, as always. Hallelujah. Appreciate everybody's testimonies. Amen. Your prayer requests. It's all encouraging. Amen. God's in charge. He's going to take care of it. Hallelujah. And that's really, the Sunday school kids can go if they haven't already. And I want to talk to you this morning about why, not to unravel all that, but just to say why you ought to have a great expectation that God is going to meet whatever needs you have. Amen. That God is going to do exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or think. Amen. He's going to do it because you are the righteousness of God in Christ. We've got to get this through our heads. It isn't what we see in the mirror that God sees. God sees us perfect, holy, righteous, accepted in the beloved. Amen. Now, what parent doesn't want to do good for his child? How much more our Heavenly Father? Amen. He wants to bless you in ways that you can't even imagine. He wants to do things for you that you haven't even dreamed up yet to ask Him for. Praise the Lord. Amen. All right. Let's go to Mark, and we'll just start right off here. Mark chapter 7. Verses 1 through 5. Mark chapter 7, beginning at verse 1, and we'll go right through verse 5. Then came together unto him the Pharisees and certain of the scribes which came from Jerusalem. And when they saw him, some of his disciples eat bread with defiled, that is to say, with unwashed hands, they found fault. For the Pharisees and all the Jews, except they wash their hands off, eat not, holding the tradition of the elders. And when they come from the market, except they wash, they eat not. And many other things there be which they have received to hold, as the washing of cups and pots, brazen vessels, and of tables. When the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, why walk not thy disciples according to the tradition of the elders, but eat bread with unwashed hands? Praise the Lord. So, just for some background, if you don't already know, based on all the cleanliness laws, if you touched a dead animal, a dead human, if you had an infection, if you had a rash, if you had sores, if you came into contact with mold, if you had any kind of a discharge, or if you ate meat from an unclean animal, you were ritually defiled, or you were unclean. So you couldn't enter the temple. You couldn't worship God. You couldn't approach God in that condition. Amen. So the washings and the efforts to stay clean and free from dirt and disease that was used by these religious people, really, it was, in Jesus' time, it was a kind of visual aid that made it clear that they were spiritually and morally unclean. They couldn't enter the presence of God unless there was some kind of spiritual purification. Amen? You ever think about your first date? I'd ask you for an actual response, but, you know, you did stuff that you didn't do just for any old thing. I mean, you put on the extra deodorant, you found the cleanest dirty shirt, you maybe splashed on a little cologne or aftershave or perfume or whatever, and I mean, you spruced up. You tried to make yourself the best you could be, the best of whatever you were. That's what you wanted to present, right? Same with for like a job interview. I mean, you don't. It's not like when you're just going to work, and you're trying to get the work. Amen. And so you make a big effort to try to be, you know, better, nicer, smell good, you know, look good, be clean, all that kind of stuff. Well, that's what we're talking about here. This is the idea or the attitude about coming to the Lord, only it's even exaggerated within the religious system. So Jesus agreed with these religious leaders. We're all unclean before God. We're all unfit for the presence of the Lord. Jesus didn't have a problem with that, but what he disagreed with them about was the source of the uncleanness and how to deal with it. Let's go on in Mark chapter 7, verses 14 through 16. And when he had called the people unto him, he said unto them, hearken unto me, every one of you, and understand, there is nothing from without a man that entering into him can defile him, but the things which come out of him, those are they that defile him. If any man have ears to hear, let him hear. Praise the Lord. So naturally speaking, you know, humanly speaking, we are unfit for the presence of God. Everybody struggles with feelings of guilt. Everybody struggles with shame, condemnation. But where do they come from? Secretly, you know, we feel like we aren't acceptable. And we have to prove ourselves to ourselves and to others that we're worthy. You know, that we're lovable, that we have value. I'm saying secretly. I'm not saying we act that way necessarily outwardly. But most isms, you know, I mean, most of the, you know, arrogance and, I don't know, you know, aggressiveness, judgmental attitudes, they come from a insecurity from inside. I've never, you know, I've known a lot of people that are very in your face, aggressive, you know, in attack mode almost all the time. And the thing that I've learned over the years is it's because they got a problem. They got an issue. And it's really not with me, it's with them. Amen. And I'm not saying we all have some degree of this kind of stuff going on. And it comes out of a sense of insecurity, inferiority, whatever, you know. People that claim, you know, others say, well, they have a superiority complex. No. In fact, they probably have a tremendous inferiority complex, and it's their way of coping with it by being, you know, acting superior, acting like they're better than everybody else, and so forth. So this is Psych 101, okay, this morning, praise the Lord. I eked out a class there one time. I was better in the psychology of the criminally insane. I did take that course. It was very uncomfortable, praise the Lord. It was a long time ago. I'm sure they've updated the textbook since then, and most of that stuff was just not true. Anyway, everybody struggles with issues. Everybody struggles with shame. Everybody struggles with guilt. But where do they come from? That's the question. Because secretly we feel like we're not acceptable. Like we have to prove things to everybody. You know? I mean, that makes life very difficult. It makes life very exhausting. When you're constantly feeling like you're on display, you know, and that you got to be really good so that everybody will like you, right? But Jesus shows us that even though we have this sense that we're unclean, he tells us that we can't shake that sense of uncleanness, and he tells us why we can't shake it. Look at Mark chapter 7, verses 17 through 19. This may all sound very fundamental, but we've talked about it before. One of the greatest reasons we don't receive from God is inside we don't feel worthy to receive anything from God. We just don't feel like we're good enough to get the very best that God has. Now, maybe we'll get some crumbs from the table. You know, I mean, maybe we'll get a little overflow. But no, God wants us to understand we are perfect in his sight. He wants to not just give you enough to get you by, not just enough to get you to your next challenge, but he wants to give you he wants to overwhelm you with his love, with his graciousness, and with his provision. Amen. He over and over and over in the Bible, there's a story after story after story. I want to be your shield and exceeding great reward. I want to do exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or think. I want to do all things. Amen, for you. All things, anything, everything, praise the Lord. So when he was entered into the house from the people, his disciples asked him concerning the parable, and he said unto them, are you so without understanding also? Do you not perceive that whatsoever thing from without entereth into the man, it cannot defile him? Because it entereth not into his heart, but into the belly, and goeth out into the draught, purging all meats. Amen. So Jesus is pretty graphic here, if you can get past the King James. Whether you eat clean or unclean. Amen. Whether the food is considered unclean or whether the food is considered clean. It goes into the mouth, it goes down into the stomach, and then literally out into the toilet. It never gets to the heart. It comes in, it goes round and round, and out it goes. Praise the Lord. Nothing from the outside makes us unclean. Now, most of us, if you think about it, religion has taught us it's everything from outside is ruining your life. Everything external is coming against you and causing you to be this mess. But Jesus is making it clear here, nothing from the outside makes us unclean. Amen? How about this? Lead me not into temptation, because I know the way. You know, I'm not trying to be smart alecky, but the truth is, lead us not into temptation, for we already know how to get there. Praise the Lord. I mean, we already know how to find the temptations. Amen? lead me not into temptation. I can find it myself. All right, Mark chapter 7, verses 20 through 23. And he said, that which cometh out of the man, that defileth the man. For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. And all these evil things come from within and defile the man. So we ask the question, why is the world so ugly? Why is it so screwed up? Why do relationships fall apart? People. People are what's wrong. It's what comes out from the inside. Self-centeredness of the human heart. Now, I want to tell you a story, just a part of a story by C.S. Lewis. I don't know if any of you read it, but it's called The Voyage of the Dawn Treader. There's a boy named Eustace. This is a perfect parable, or actually even a metaphor for what all of us are dealing with. And there's a boy named Eustace, and everybody hates him. And he hates everybody. He's selfish. He's mean. Nobody can get along with him. But he finds himself magically on this boat. It's called the Dawn Treader. And he's taken a great voyage. And at one point, this boat pulls into an island. And Eustace wanders off and finds a cave. And the cave is filled with diamonds and rubies and gold. And he thinks, I'm rich. And immediately, because he is who he is, he thinks, now he's going to be able to pay everybody back. And I don't mean what he borrowed. I mean, he's going to get even with everybody. Anybody that's ever laughed at him, anybody that ever stepped on him, anybody that ever slighted him, he's going to get even. And then Eustace falls asleep on this pile of treasure, which he doesn't realize is a treasure that belongs to a dragon. And because he falls asleep with greedy, dragonish kind of thoughts in his heart, when he wakes up, he becomes the dragon. This big, this terrible and ugly dragon. And then he realizes there's no way out. He can't go back to the boat. He's going to be left behind. He's going to be stuck on this island all alone. He's going to be horrible all of his life. And he falls into despair. One day, the great dragon, Aslan, shows up and leads him to this clear pool of water. And he tells him to undress. And suddenly, Eustace realizes that undress means take off the dragon skin. He begins to gnaw and claw at the scales. And he realizes that he can actually shed his skin. And working at it, he finally peels off this skin. But he finds that underneath, he's got another dragon skin. So he tries it a second time and a third time without any success. In the end, the lion says, you're going to have to let me go deeper. And here's how Eustace tells the story. I was afraid of his claws. I can tell you, it was frightening. But I was pretty nearly desperate by now. The very first tear that he made was so deep that I thought it had gone right into my heart. And when he began pulling the skin off, it hurt worse than anything. Well, he peeled the beastly stuff right off, just as I thought I had done it myself the other three times, only they hadn't hurt. And there it was, lying on the grass, only ever so much thicker and darker and more knobbly looking than the others had been. Then he caught hold of me and threw me into the water. It smarted like anything, but only for a moment. And then I saw I turned into a boy again. sinful behavior. Is really just self-centeredness. Look at Mark chapter 9, 43 verse through 48. Mark 9, 43 through 48. And if thy hand offend thee, cut it off. It's better for thee to enter into the maimed, life maimed, than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched. Where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. That's all right. And if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It's better for thee to enter halt into life than having two feet to be cast into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched. Where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire, where the worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. So, sinful behavior, which is the reference here to the hand and the foot, that's, he's using this in this parable. Sinful behavior is the reference to the hand and the foot. Sinful desires is the reference to the eyes, which is like fire, right? But Jesus points out here that our biggest problem, what makes us most unclean, isn't our foot or our eye. It's our heart. If the problem were the foot or the eye, it'd be drastic, but it would be possible to deal with it. But we can't cut out our heart. So, external solutions don't deal with problems. You can dress people up a certain way. You can cause them to not do certain things and not have certain things, but it doesn't really change anything as far as God's concerned. That's religious. That's the religious kind of approach to everything. It's all outside in. It's all external fix-up without necessarily ever having anything internal changed. Jesus has made it clear. Our focus is on the wrong thing. It isn't so much what people externally is going on, it's what's happened internally. Now, I know that sounds counterintuitive, and it certainly is counter-religion, but it is exactly Christian, based on what Jesus himself has said. I know it's difficult for us to swallow that sometimes because we want it to have more to do with what we do than who we are. We are new creatures in Christ, even though our external may not measure up to that. Praise God. Outside in does not work. It doesn't work. Because our problems work from the inside out. Praise God. Religion says stay away from bad movies, bad behavior, bad people. Pray, read the Bible, be good, and then God will see that you're worthy, and he'll come and heal your heart. The problem is, Jesus said, that doesn't work. You never feel that you're good enough because your heart doesn't change. We're talking about spirit here, you know. Romans chapter 1, verse 17. Now, I'm not attacking you. I'm attacking the issues that we deal with because we don't understand our identity. And that's what Jesus is trying to get to more than anything. He's not trying to make people feel like idiots. He's trying to get them to understand what really happens in a person's life when they're born again, when they come to faith in Christ. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. Now, that's what we just talked about with Debbie earlier. The attacks that are on her. It's true of all of us. I mean, we're all got some kind of attacks going on all the time, right? We live by faith. Amen? And it's not even our faith. I've taught on this plenty of times. It's the faith of Christ.
Amen.
We're just putting our hope, our expectation in Him.
Yes.
Trusting in His faith, that His faith is sufficient. Therefore, my faith doesn't have to be perfect because His is perfect. It was perfect.
Yes.
And has perfected me.
Amen.
Now, granted, there are times when my faith is greater than others. But it doesn't alter what God's intention is for me or what God will do for me. Because He's not doing it based on how great my particular faith is at any given time. He's doing it based on my belief in Christ and His perfect faith. Right? I mean, He has obtained everything for me. He's already got it for me. And likewise for you. Let's look at Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 22. Yes, please. Verse 22. For though thou wash thee with nitre and take thee much soap, yet thine iniquity is marked before me, saith the Lord God. All right, back to Mark chapter 7, verses 14 through 16. This is external. You can scrub it all you want. But unless there's something changed inside, nothing changes as far as God's concerned. On the other hand, if God does His work, only the work that He can do internally, then He sees us as perfect, even though externally we're still a mess. And when He had called all the people unto Him, He said unto them, hearken unto me, every one of you, and understand, there is nothing from without a man that entering into him can defile him. But the things which come out of him, those are they that defile the man. If any man have ears to hear, let him hear. It's like the story of Eustace. Eustace thinks, I can just clean this stuff up a little bit. But Athlon, which is a type of Christ, what he does is says, look, this is much deeper than that. And it isn't about peeling the skin off. It's like he went right to the heart of the matter. And what ends up on the ground is far uglier than anything he could have peeled off of himself. It's what's wrong on the inside. And then he throws him into this water as if to say, you're clean now. And what does the kid see? He sees he's a kid again. He's innocent again. Right? He's washed. He's cleansed. That's what God does for us. He takes us back to the garden. Not to be better what we are, but to be innocent. Innocent. You know, there's a huge difference between innocence and being right. Praise the Lord. Little kids are innocent because they do a lot of naughty stuff, right? But they don't know naughty from good.
Exactly.
They're innocent. So you can't punish a one-year-old or a two-year-old the way you would an 18-year-old, right? You don't hold them accountable because they're innocent. I mean, they come and say, Mommy, where do babies come from? They don't want to know. They don't want a biology lesson. Right? That's why we tell them the stork brought them or, you know, fairies left it or whatever you want to say. I mean, you know, because they're not going to understand any of it anyway. They're innocent. And if there's a crime in this country, it's stealing the innocence from our children.
Yes.
It's forcing them to be adults when they're still just kids. They don't get a chance to ever really just be children, which is a whole other story, but praise the Lord. God tells us you're innocent. He treats us as adults in terms of our inheritance, but He responds to our behavior as innocence.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. He doesn't come with a big stick. He doesn't come with a belt. He doesn't come with an open hand. He just says, come here, baby. You're so cute. Now, I'm not saying the behavior's cute, but you're still cute. And the behavior hasn't changed my opinion of you in any way. Hallelujah. What Jesus is saying is the cleanliness laws have been fulfilled. That's what he's telling these people. In him, the cleanliness laws are taken care of. The temple had three parts. I'm sure you all know this because we've talked about it. Had the outer court, had the inner court, and then it had the Holy of Holies. And the Holy of Holies was surrounded by the veil. And inside that veil, inside the Holy of Holies, was the Ark of the Covenant. And atop of the Ark of the Covenant is the mercy seat. Within the Ark are the Ten Commandments, the stones. Also the Aaron's rod that budded, and you know, the manna that was given to him. So this is all in the Ark. The mercy seat is upon the Ark so that you could not, and anybody that saw Indiana Jones knows you don't want to look in the Ark. Right? Praise the Lord. Why? The reason that the blood was sprinkled on the mercy seat was because God doesn't want us looking at the commandments. He doesn't want us looking at the Ark. He wants us to see the mercy seat. The elasterion is what it's called. Amen?
Amen?
What religion does is constantly peeking in the Ark. Yeah. The blood's not doing you any good because all you're seeing is what you're not doing.
Exactly.
But God has so designed it that if you get in, if you can get access here, I don't want you looking in the Ark.
Right.
I want you to see the blood.
Exactly.
I want you to see my mercy. I'm not judging you based on what's in the Ark. I'm judging you based on what's on the Ark, the mercy seat, where God sat to judge Israel when they came and brought the blood on the Day of Atonement. Amen?
Amen.
Look at this. Inside that Ark, or inside the Holy of Holies, on top of the Ark is the mercy seat, and there is the Shekinah glory of God. Amen? It represents the holiness, the glory of God, the power of God. Amen? It's a cloud. It's like the cloud that led them, amen, during the daytime when they were in the wilderness. Praise the Lord. Let's go to Leviticus, Sheila, chapter 16, and we'll start with just verses 1 and 2. Leviticus 16, verses 1 and 2. So the Lord spake unto Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron when they offered before the Lord and died. They offered strange fire. You know, I don't know if you know the story, but these were priests, the sons of the high priest, and they were doing wicked in the temple, and they died as a result of it. So here the Lord tells Moses after the death of these two sons of Aaron when they offered before the Lord and died. And the Lord said unto Moses, speak unto Aaron thy brother that he come not at all times into the holy place within the veil before the mercy seat, which is upon the ark, that he die not. So he's saying, tell him, don't come in here, or he'll die. I know the King James makes everything look backwards, but that's what he's actually saying, so that he won't die. For I'm going to appear in the cloud upon the mercy seat, and he better not be in here when I do. He can't just come bopping in here, or he'll die. Amen. All right, skip now to verses 12 and 13. And he shall take a censer full of burning coals off the fire from off the altar before the Lord, and his hand full of sweet incense, beaten small, and bring it within the veil. And he shall put the incense upon the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of the incense may cover the mercy seat that is upon the testimony, so that he doesn't die. The presence of God, this is a dangerous place. If you haven't figured it out, it is dangerous, amen. It's a dangerous place. But look at this, Zechariah chapter 3, verses 1 to 3, or through 3, 1 through 3. And he showed me Joshua, the high priest, which is what Aaron was, where we just read. Don't be sneaking in and out of here. You got one opportunity to come in here once a year, and you better come the way you're supposed to come, and there better be incense, there better be everything going on like it's supposed to be, or you're going to be dead. You come in here any other time, I don't care what you're bringing, you're going to die.
Right.
It's your only opportunity to come into the presence of God, and you better not come in unless you come exactly the way I tell you. Everything's got to be perfect. So here's the high priest, Joshua, and he's standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to resist him. And the Lord said unto Satan, "The Lord rebuke thee, O Satan, even the Lord that hath chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire?" Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and stood before the angel. Now he's in the presence of God. But he's filthy. He hasn't got any incense burning. He doesn't have any of the sweet smelling stuff. He's got nothing. He's there filthy. Praise the Lord. He's defiled in the Holy of Holies. How? One might ask. I mean, that's the first thing that comes into my mind. How do you get away with this? Because Zechariah had a prophetic vision. And this vision was so that he could see us the way God sees us. In spite of our efforts to be pure, to be good, to be moral, to cleanse ourselves, God sees our heart is full of filth. It's corrupt. All of our morality, all of our good works don't really get to the heart. No matter what we do, we're unfit for the presence of God. All right, Zechariah chapter 3, verse 4. "Be ye not as your fathers, unto whom the former prophets have cried, saying, Thus saith the Lord of hosts, Turn ye now from your evil ways and from your evil doings. But they did not hear, nor hearken unto me, saith the Lord." I'm not sure if that's right. That's Zechariah chapter 4. Excuse me, Zechariah chapter 3, verse 4. "And he answered and spake unto those that stood before him, saying, Take away the filthy garments from him. And unto him he said, Behold, I have caused thine iniquity to pass from thee, and I will clothe thee with a change of raiment." Now, who's doing what here? Joshua's doing nothing but standing there and getting the exchange. Praise the Lord. All right, skip down now to verses 8 and 9, still in Zechariah 3. "Hear now, O Joshua the high priest, thou and thy fellows that sit before thee, for they are men wondered at. For behold, I will bring forth my servant, the branch," which of course is Christ. "For behold, the stone that I have laid before Joshua, upon one stone shall be seven eyes," the seven spirits of God as it's referred to in other places. "Behold, I will engrave the graving thereof, saith the Lord of hosts, and I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day." Praise the Lord. Here's another prophecy that one day the sacrifices are going to be over and the cleanliness laws will be fulfilled. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. "For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." Come on, I mean, this is fundamental stuff, but it's the reason most of us struggle with expecting God to do what God has said he'd do. He's telling us, look, in no uncertain terms, you deserve healing. You deserve financial blessing. You deserve to be the head and not the tail. Above and not beneath, the lender, not the borrower. You deserve to be blessed coming in. You deserve to be blessed coming out. That's something that's very difficult for us to accept from a religious point of view. But it is exactly how God sees us. You have every right to expect exceeding abundantly above all that I can ask or think. Why? Because he's given you an exchange. He has taken everything that kept you from those blessings and put the atonement and the righteousness of Christ in you so that you have every reason to expect your inheritance. You should expect that God's your shield and exceeding great reward. You should expect, I don't care what the what the lawyer said. I don't care what the banker says. I don't care what the doctor says. Jesus Christ has given me a promise and he cannot lie. And I'm going to get it because I deserve it in Christ. And my deserving is not based on me. It's based on Christ in me, the hope of glory. My hope of glory, my hope of receiving everything that God has for me, the power of God, is the Christ that's in me, not in what's going on around me or around me. Praise God. So God clothed Jesus in my sin and your sin. And Jesus took our punishment so that we, like Joshua the high priest, can get this. Revelation chapter 19, verses 7 and 8. Whoa, I'm getting happy. I got some stuff. I need some stuff. You know what? I mean, I got issues like everybody else does. And I'm believing that God's going to do it, not because I deserve it, not because I've been a really good boy. Amen? But because he's a really good God and has accounted his goodness to me and sees me that way. He wants me blessed. He wants me shouting and running up and down these aisles saying, look what God has done for me. Praise the Lord. I didn't deserve it, but man, he spoiled me rotten. And he's happy about it. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and his wife hath made herself ready. All she did was get ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. Praise God. Woo, hallelujah. All we got to do is get ready. Get ready to be blessed. Get ready for God to pour out on you everything that you've ever dreamt of, desired. As long as it's not contrary to his word, you have every reason to expect it.
Absolutely. Yes.
Praise God. Doing from the outside in. It does not work. That's from the very mouth of Christ, the word of God. God has clothed us in costly, clean garments. And it cost him his blood. And it's the only thing that can deal with our heart problem. Amen? You can skin yourself from now till Jesus comes, but you're still going to be flesh. But he has done a heart transplant. Amen? That's what God said. I'll put my laws in their heart. Right? Now, that doesn't mean, because he's put his laws in our heart, that all of a sudden we're perfect. What he's done is put his laws and the fulfillment and the completion of those laws in our spirit man. We think this. We think, well, God gave us the Holy Ghost so that we can overcome sin, so that we're not tempted anymore to do bad, so that we don't screw up. No. He gave us the Holy Spirit to purify us and to keep us when we sin. Hear me. The Holy Spirit is in my spirit. They are one. You can call it Christ in you, the hope of glory. You can call it us and God being one. The Holy Spirit dwells within my spirit. They are one. They become one. What that does is keep me sanctified, purified, accepted to God, even when I fail. That's what he's talking about, amen, when he says, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. God tempts no man. Amen? But he knows we're all going to be tempted because we know the way. Right? We know how to get to where the temptation is. We go looking for it. But the answer to that is, within me is what delivers me from that very temptation. I'm not saying that I won't go and do whatever I'm tempted to do. Right? Because I'm tempted to do it because I want to do it. Otherwise, I wouldn't be tempted. Right? It wouldn't be a temptation if I didn't want to do it. But what God has done is place within me his spirit that keeps me cleansed even when I succumb to temptation. I'm still delivered from the consequences.
Yes.
So, well, now, look out. Katie, bar the door. Let's all get down to the club. Let's get high. Let's party. Let's, like it's 1999. I'm not saying go ahead and do whatever you want to do. I'm just saying I already know you're going to do some stuff. And I'm not, you know, it's not like I've got ESP. The Bible's clear. In the flesh, you're fail. That's why you got to be born again. That's why you got to have the Spirit of God to keep you, amen, from the consequences of your failure. We're not encouraging sin, but it's the old age-old story. If we don't preach it the way Paul preached it, and cause people to say, well, you're giving people a license to sin, or you're saying that you should sin more so that grace will abound more. If we don't preach it that strong, then we're not preaching what Paul preached. If people misunderstand. But even if you don't, if you just really try your very best to not give in to whatever it is, anger, you know, bitterness, jealousy, strife, drunkenness, whatever, anything, adultery, whatever it might be. They're all the same. Each one may have a different impact on us individually, but as far as God's concerned, it's all the same stuff. So maybe I control myself and I don't mess around with other women. I don't shoot up drugs because I already know what the consequences of that is. And I better skip that one. Praise the Lord. You know, I was going to say anger, you know, but I still get angry sometimes, you know. But, you know, jealousy, whatever it might be, that I feel like I kind of got the corner on that. The problem is all I got to do is have the issue. Because if I'm thinking about it, see, I got a problem already, even if I don't do it. You know, it's one thing, if you make it to 67, I'm going to tell you something. The chances of you committing adultery are far less than they are at 37. Yeah. There are not as many people want a 67-year-old lover. Oh, come on. Lighten up out there. I'm telling you, sometimes if you just live long enough, you quit doing a lot of the sins. That isn't because you're a whole lot better. It's just the opportunities aren't always there. Praise the Lord. I'm not looking, baby. I'm not looking. I'm just saying. You understand what I'm saying? That doesn't make me holier because I'm not doing everything I would have done if I could have done it. You know, we don't rob banks because we don't want to get caught and go to jail for 20 years, right? But if I could just walk in and know that I'm walking out of there with $500,000, and I wasn't going to get caught. Oh, that would really cause me to stay awake at night for a while to try to decide, now what do I really want to do here? Because I'm not going to jail. And I could probably do some good with some of that. Right? So you see, in the heart is deceitfully wicked. But we have natural laws and so forth to kind of control that stuff. But it doesn't make us righteous because we obey the law. Even when we do obey the law. Because inside of us is something that is not controlled. So I'm not any better than a bank robber. I'm not any better than an adulterer. Amen. That's the teaching that Jesus tries to get across to us. Not that we become, indifferent to our attitudes and our behavior, but that we don't let them dominate us. And we trust in the goodness and the grace of God who has declared us righteous. Now, here's the deal. If we get that inside, then our outside behavior will change automatically. But we can do everything we want to try to get people to clean up, straighten up, act right, and it doesn't work unless they understand what God has declared them to be and His acceptance of them. That is the great exchange. And that causes us to do more righteous acts, quote unquote, by accident than you could have ever done through a religious dictatorial system. That's everything that God's trying to tell us. I'm a good God. I love you. I want you to be blessed. And it's not based on your perception. It's based on my reality. Exactly. Religion is perceptions, concepts. Amen? And that's why we got so many of them. God is not a concept. God is not a religion. God is reality. He's ultimate reality. In fact, He's really the only reality. The only reality. And He has declared you righteous.
Yes.
Acceptable. Not the way we understand acceptable. Just eking in. Just barely got accepted into college. You know? God barely found a woman that would accept me. No. God says you are perfect and I accept you. Because God's demands are high. He hasn't lowered the standard. Amen. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying. He hasn't forgotten. He hasn't quit thinking that sin is evil. Amen. Sin is still bad. Sin will still be judged. And it'll be judged by the law. But we have already been judged and found innocent in Christ. Now God would be schizophrenic, a liar, a hypocrite, and everything else if He tried to enforce double indemnity or tried to convict us for a crime that we've already been punished for in Christ. God is a God of laws and justice, but it's perfect justice. And the justice has been satisfied in Christ. Which means you can only see yourself the way God sees you. Just like Jesus.
Amen.
That's what a Christian is.
Yes.
It's Christ. We are... It sounds blasphemous, but no more than it sounded blasphemous when Jesus said, I and my Father are one.
Right.
He's making Himself equal with God. That's a stoning. And Jesus said, no, I'm just telling you the truth. I'm not trying to just rock your religious world. I'm just telling you the truth, and whatever that does to it is your issue. Now, didn't He say, as He is, so are we in this present world? Not just in the sweet by and by when we fly off to heaven, but as far as God's concerned, whatever Jesus is, we are that right here and right now.
Amen.
Now that ought to give you some boldness to expect, just like Jesus did, that whatever I declare in my Father's name, He's going to give it to me. Why? Because my Father loves me. If I'm calling for healing, I know I've already got healing because He's already given it to me. All I'm doing is giving God the glory. All I'm doing is saying it's not based on how good I've been, it's based on Him. So all things are possible. If when you pray you believe that you have them, you got it.
Yes.
Oh, praise the Lord, I got to quit. And it isn't perfect faith. It isn't like, okay, you know, I prayed for 33 days, I fasted for 6 months, you know, I can barely drag myself to the altar, but now God's going to move. That is the most hypocritical mentality that you could possibly have. Because now you think you have manipulated God. Now you're making it look like it's because of what you did that God's going to move. Now, there's nothing wrong with fasting, there's nothing wrong with praying, as long as you understand what it's really all about. It's to get you to see God as God really is, and how God sees you, puts you in a spiritual frame of mind. It gets you in tune. Praise the Lord. Nothing. God, I mean, this is just simple English language, but think about it. Nothing shall be impossible if you can believe. Now, I don't know what you got going on, but some of the stuff that I'm dealing with in the natural, I don't have a clue what to do. I mean, I don't know what I could do to change it. So why not trust God? Why not just rest in His goodness, in His promise, and believe? Whatever happens, God's in charge. Amen? I know we worry too much sometimes. This is what I've done. Ever since I've been saved. Sally will verify it. If I felt like this isn't against God, I just did it. Because I'll be the first one to tell you, I didn't always know what God wanted. But He did. I just did what was available to do. And God blessed it. And if it wasn't, I mean, I've had some crap jobs, I got to tell you. I've had some good jobs, good paying jobs, but I've had some crap jobs too. I had people ripping me off and taking advantage of me when I first got saved. I had people going into my files where I worked and stealing my prospects, stealing the contacts that I had spent hours and days and weeks developing so that they could make the sales. And the guy that was doing it was the nephew of the branch manager. That got ugly really quick because he was supposed to be a Christian too. But the Lord took care of me. And in fact, when I got out of that job, I lost money on that job. And God gave me another job, which didn't look like it was going to be near as good a job. It was driving a dump truck, hauling scrap iron off the docks out of the Houston Channel, come up to Vidor, into a steel yard. I made more money there, probably as much money there as I've ever made anywhere in sales, in some of the best sales jobs, because I worked 7 days a week, 12 hours a day a lot of times, all overtime. And half the time, I was sitting in a truck with the motor turned off reading the Bible. Because the crane was down or they sunk a barge in the middle of the channel and they couldn't get any more up, but they still had to pay me. Because we had a contract with the steel mill, International Mill Service. That wasn't bad. I was learning about Jesus and getting paid good money. And when I took the job, I thought, this is crazy. You know, I mean, I'm not a truck driver or anything else, but little did I know, I didn't need to. I just knew how to sit in a seat and hold onto the steering wheel. Praise the Lord. I'm just saying, God, we worry too much about our figuring everything out when God knows and God loves us. Hey, I had some jobs, like I said, they were just crap. But they didn't last long. I'd never been fired from a job. And when I left Eagle Iron Works, I was going to go back into sales. This is how crazy I was. Selling insurance. Oh, my Lord. I was a salesman, but I don't think anybody can sell insurance. You have to have a gun. You have to use a gun to get people to buy insurance. So anyway, it was just awful. So I took a job with Speedy Delivery. I mean, this is like out of Mr. Rogers, the neighborhood. You ever see? It's actually the name of the company. And my territory was from Des Moines all the way out to Audubon and then back. Guthrie Center, all these places. About 10-hour days minimum. And you had to run all the time. It was always hustling and stuff. And it was a nightmare. They fired me. First job I'd ever been fired from, except for my own dad. He fired me, and I quit a couple of times. But I mean, that was family. But they fired me. I was just dumbfounded. I couldn't believe it. Me? You're firing me? I know I'm probably one of the best employees you've got. No. I just, anyway. After that, I know this is dragging on, but it's not quite 12. But I'm just telling you. Now, I was getting paid. I mean, they were paying me, but it was just a mess. And then I took a job with a company called Novelties out of Michigan. They flew me up there, rented a car. They took me all through the whole thing. Went, traveled around with one of their top salesmen. Came back, and I had Iowa, the northwestern part of the state, all the way up to Minnesota. And you think, well, that's not a bad deal, but you don't know what I was selling. My dad used to say, if you can sell, you'll never be unemployed. Well, I was selling farting Santa Clauses. Yes, that was not a... Yeah, farting Santa Clauses and belching witches. Oh, yeah, I mean, that, and I had to look people... What do you do for a living? I'm in sales, territory sales. I'd just like to leave it at that. Yeah, all these quick trips and come and goes and all that's what I did all day long. 6 o'clock in the morning when they opened, I'd be there with my ho ho ho. Now, I mean, there was other things too, but those were the two most humiliating, and they were the best sellers, by the way, too. Yeah, I did that for a year. And I did make good money because I was the Santa salesman of the universe. I could really sell some farting Santa Clauses. I had a gift. Yeah. But I did make good money. But I was gone all the time because I didn't want to show my face in my hometown. No, I was on the road all the time, Monday through Friday. And, you know, that's why I'm pastoring again. I mean, I'm laughing, but that's the truth. Because I'd been offered to take, the guy wanted me to take this church. I didn't really want to. I'd been out of the ministry for a few years, and of course I was having such great success in the secular world. It made me reevaluate. And I'd pray, I'd stay up, I'd get done usually with my day around 6 o'clock or so, and then I'd have to do all my paperwork and fax it into the company offices each day. So it was usually 8 o'clock or after before I'd get done with that, before I'd even eat. 10 o'clock, I got to be up at 5 because I got to be back on the first stop at 6 in the morning. And there were many nights, this is not to brag or anything else, but just to show how desperate I was, that I'd be kneeled by my bed in a motel room somewhere, not even knowing where that was, usually from day to day, and praying and saying, God, look, I'll do this forever if this is what you want. But it ain't what I want. So if you've got something else for me, I want it. And I'll take it, whatever it is. And right after that's when Jerry asked me to take the church, and I didn't at first, and I went through the whole thing, and I told him, look, the only way I'm taking it is if Sally asked me to. And I knew she wasn't crazy about it because we spent all kinds of money in the first church that we started because I worked full-time and she was working part-time and full-time at different points in there. And not only did we not get any income from the church, we were taking our income to keep church going. So we were spending everything we had to keep a church alive, you know, because it was just a startup. It was just people that didn't know the Lord and anything about giving or anything else. But nevertheless, I knew she wasn't crazy about jumping back into it because it's time consuming, it's demanding, it's, you know, a lot of the junk you put up with too. But I came home one night and I hadn't said anything more to her about it and told the Lord that I wouldn't unless she says it. If she does, I'm gonna believe it's you. And sure enough, I came home without saying anything. She said, I think you're supposed to take that church. Now, I knew that was the Lord. And when I prayed about it, because the Lord had told me, I don't want you working a secular job. I want you to do what I've called you to do. Not that and then whatever else you think, because I want to be your source. I don't want you to think that your job is your source and this is just what you do on the side. Well, I'd already been down that road and I didn't think so. And of course, this church wasn't that large and I figured, this is just asking for trouble. And those of you that were here, remember that building sucked the energy right out of it. I mean, there was no insulation, and summertime it was hot and the air conditioner ran 24 hours a day. In the wintertime it was cold and had to run all the time, plus the expenses of the building and everything else. And it was clear on the south side of Des Moines, and I live 30 miles from here. So it was like a 45-mile drive, and I was doing it every day. Nevertheless, I was praying there one day, and I said, Lord, I know what you told me, but am I mistaken? And I swear this is what the Lord told me. That's why it meant so much when Tim mentioned this last week. He said, I'll be your shield and exceeding great reward. Not this church. You know, not, you know what I mean? Not just the money that you're going to get from this, but I'm going to be your shield and exceeding great reward. And I believed it. I'm not saying I haven't been challenged, but I believed it, and God has taken care of us. Sally will tell you. She had to leave her job shortly after that because of an injury, and they wouldn't let her go back to work in the same position that she had before, so she had to take an early retirement. And we didn't have any other income. We were cleaning houses, cleaning construction sites, because the income from the church wasn't sufficient. And all the time I'm still saying, the Lord is my shield and my exceeding great reward. He's providing this. I painted houses. I painted two or three houses for one of my stepsons. But we made it. And so when God gave us this building and literally gave it to us so that we didn't have to pay utilities, it was his way of saying, see, if you trust me, I will be your shield and your exceeding great reward when you look to me to be your source. And I'm saying, I've stumbled through this stuff ever since I first got saved. I'm not perfect. I've made all kinds of mistakes. But God has never held it against me.
Thank you, Lord.
Other people have. But what do I care about them? You know, I mean, why should I worry? If God is for me, who can be against me? And that's what I'm trying to get across. I haven't understood all that I'm preaching today. I don't know everything yet. Don't know that I ever will in this life. But I learned some things more out of experiencing the goodness of God and the love of God than I ever did out of just going to a class or reading a book or studying something. The reality of what God wants to be in our lives is just incredible. So I have every reason to believe whatever challenges I'm facing in the near future or in the distant future or whatever, he's more than a match for it. Even if it doesn't look like it, even if when I'm cleaning a construction site, I'm thinking, shield and exceeding great reward, right? Somebody's probably snickering right now in heaven, like, what a sap, you know, he bought in. No, God is looking, because Satan wants to test us. And all he's testing is your faith in God, whether you believe God or don't believe God. And all God wants is to see, you trust me, I care, I love you, I'm going to take care of you. And he'll do the same thing. He's not a respecter of persons. God knows that. He's been good to me, not because of me, because of him. And that's the truth. And that is the way he wants to be for you. He wants you to expect it. He wants you to know, God, he does love me. He does care. He's going to do this for me because of who he is and because of what he's given to me.
Yes. Three people.
And here's the deal. I got stabbed in the back. Sales is an ugly business in a lot of ways. And so there's a certain amount of freedom to it, but you always got somebody trying to take advantage of you, whether it's your supervisor, your manager, your regional, whoever it might be. Always, somebody's always trying to get the glory for something. But what I learned after I came to the Lord was, don't worry about it. Don't defend yourself. Just don't worry about it. I'll be your defense. I'll be your shield and your exceeding great reward. And when you leave it in God's hands, I haven't always been perfect at this. I've lost it a few times and got stupid. But for the most part, I've just, when it's happening, I just say, Lord, you've seen it. You've seen it. You know, I'm not going to get into this mess. I'm not going to get in here and try to defend myself. I'm not going to try to pump myself up. I'm not going to, whatever you got to do, you just do it. I just want to be taken care of. And he always has.
Yeah.
He's blessed me in other ways that I didn't expect to be blessed. And so even though I may not have always had the situations resolved the way I felt I deserved to have them resolved, God always rewarded me anyway. Mm-hmm. If not in that situation, through something else. So, you know, again, it's just learning to trust God, no matter what it looks like. No matter, you know, I say this, if you feel like, you know, and this isn't just for you, Peter, this is something I want everybody to, you got to think these things through for yourself. You got to make decisions. It's your family, it's your livelihood and so forth. But for me personally, I've just said, Lord, I'm just going to do this and trust that you're going to take care of me. Now, I'm not saying I haven't made mistakes, but he's always taken care of me and got me to where it was he wanted me to be in the first place, even though I didn't have a clear understanding of that. I've never been a quote-unquote prophetic person concerning me. Now, I've had prophecies, I've had dreams, I've had many things about other people, but not me. For me, I've just had to trust the Lord. And so I just did. And he's never failed me. It looked like failure a few times, but he's never failed me.
Amen.
And he'll do the very same thing for you.
Right.
Say praise the Lord, so I'll shut up and you can all go home. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's the bottom line is God's done it all. There's nothing more for us to do except to trust him.
Amen.
Amen. Trust in his goodness. Trust in his grace. Trust in his generosity. And he'll be the same for you. He'll be your shield and exceeding great reward. That scripture doesn't have my name on it. It just had my name on it the day I read it.
Amen.
But it's for everybody. It's for anybody.
That's right.
Praise the Lord. And how did that happen? Because I'm supposed to shut up, but I'm going to tell you. It happened because Abraham put himself in God's hands. He had all this stuff that he'd gotten. And instead of keeping it, he gave it to Melchizedek, who was the type of Christ, high priest without beginning or end. And the result was the high priest blesses Abraham. Amen. And gives him communion, wine and bread, the high priest gives him, you know, connecting in the metaphor for Jesus and us becoming one with him through that. And then immediately following this, now it looked like, as an observer, it looked like, what an idiot. He's got everything he needs. He's got all the spoil. He's got the servants. He's got everything going for him. Just throw your bucks and go for it, you know. But instead he just said, nope, I don't want any of it because I've already told the Lord he's going to be my source. And because he did that, God said, now, watch how I can work. I'm going to be, not only am I going to protect you, but I am going to be the reward that you're looking for. I'm going to be your shield, an exceeding great reward. And that's what he wants to be for all of us. When we let go of the stuff that we think we got to control, give it to him and watch him take over.
Amen.
That's Christianity.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen?
God bless you all, dismissed in Jesus' name. Have a great week. Expect great things.
Thank you, Lord.
Because we got a great God.